Good morning, good afternoon, or good evening, depending on from where you're joining us today. Welcome to the second half of the ALM Expo 2011 conference and to this broadcast, The Agility Mindset, Principles for Collaborating with Principles for Collaborating and Innovating with Agility. This webcast is brought to you by CM Crossroads and is sponsored by IBM. I'm Francesca Mathieu, and I'll be your moderator for today. Now, in a few minutes, Adrian Cho will join us to discuss the Agile mindset, but first, a few housekeeping details. Our live cast environment is intended to be completely interactive, so you'll have the ability to post your questions at any time during the broadcast or chat with other attendees about this session. We will address audience questions at the conclusion of the webcast during the Q&A period. If we're unable to get to all of your questions during the presentation, someone will follow up via email. Now, to ask a question, simply use the live chat window located to the right of the screen under the tab Chat. You can also undock the chat box from the screen using the pop-out button at the bottom right corner of the chat box. That way it doesn't get hidden behind the slides. Now, if you'd like to share your thoughts about today's presentation, use the Facebook tab located to the right of the screen. Log into your account and you'll have the ability to share your experience with your friends. You can also share the experience through Twitter. Click on the Twitter tab to the right of the screen and join the conversation. Your tweets will show up in the Twitter roll to the right. Now make sure to use the hashtag #ALMExpo11. That's #ALMExpo11 if you're tweeting. Now, if you'd like a copy of the presentation materials for today's session, you'll find a button to download those slides on the Links tab at the right of the webcast window. A recording of the entire live broadcast, including Q&A, will be available in about 24 hours at the same location, so you can come back again or recommend it to a friend. All right, and now I'm going to take it or bring you live to Lee Copeland, who will introduce the speaker.
Audience, welcome back, virtual folks. Glad to have you here. Again, we acknowledge our sponsors and thank them for their contribution to making this virtual audience possible. I now want to introduce Adrian Cho. I have a bio that I want to read here. And then I might expand on that just a touch. Adrian Cho plays jazz on multiple fronts. At IBM, he's the Senior Development Manager for Rational's Jazz ALM Initiative, with responsibility for delivering Rational Team Concert, Rational Quality Manager, and Rational Requirements Composer. And that project incorporates contributions from over 200 software developers working across North America, Europe, and the Asia-Pacific region to deliver major releases annually and maintenance for multiple systems. And so he's a computer wizard, he's a computer geek, but on the other hand, he's also a musician. He performs as a bassist and a conductor. He's the founder and artistic director of the Ottawa Jazz Orchestra, has presented almost 30 major concerts and premiered over 10 seminal jazz works over the past 7 years. He teaches and speaks to universities and business audiences about software development and jazz history, about collaboration and innovation. And his new book called The Jazz Process has been endorsed by a diverse collection of thought leaders. I've read it and I think it's just a fantastic book. We have copies at the bookstore. If you'd like to browse, I'd invite you to do that. I'm just really pleased to be able to have Adrian here and introduce him to you. Adrian Cho.
Thanks. Thanks, Lee. Good morning. Hope you're all doing well today. So, at this conference, you'll hear a lot about tools and technology and processes and methodologies. And all these things are very important, without a doubt. But the thing is, you can have the best tools and the best technology and a great process, a great plan for how to do your work. But if you don't have the right mindset, if you don't have people who are thinking in the right way, and if you're not adhering to some of the really important fundamental principles, you can still mess up big time. So really what I want to talk today is about the principles that are important. How do you put together a team or an organization that can do Agile, and how do you execute? So although we're talking principles, we're talking in generalities. We're also going to get down to the specifics of those generalities. So the context for what I'm talking about is jazz, because that's something I know well. And a lot of my research has been about the parallels between what jazz musicians do and what people do in other disciplines. But this also applies to other domains as well, sports, military operations, business in general. So if we just go back a little bit in history and look at 100 years ago, the early 20th century, this was a time of great change. There were major events, a war, the Depression, and many cultural and social changes. Immigration, people were moving to big cities, urbanization. There was a lot of racial conflict in North America. Gender was a big issue at that time. Women were coming to the forefront. Alcohol, you may know about the Prohibition. There was a time when alcohol was forbidden to be manufactured or sold. And even on moral fronts as well, there were a lot of changes. But at the same time, this was also an era in which there was great innovation. Some of the major things that were happening were the availability of automobiles for the mass market and commercial air travel. So this is interesting because it allows people to come together, right? People who might have been, for example, on opposite sides of a country trying to work together can now come together. So it's really closing those distances. And big changes in media. We had radio and movies with sound. So this enabled performers and advertisers to deliver much richer forms of content. And amongst all of this was this new artistic innovation. The music was jazz, and with it was this form of dancing, swing dance. So this artistic innovation happened really as a result of, or was born out of, all of these changes that were happening. Jazz is a fusion of black and white music, African musical elements and European musical elements. So that's the race part there. And many of you may know that, jazz was, it grew up effectively. It was played a lot in what were called speakeasies at the time, where alcohol was banned. And jazz was seen as an immoral form of music at the time, which is often the case, right, with each sort of new generation. So, you know, it was the kind of music that parents didn't want their kids going out and listening to, let alone dancing to. And we saw all these kinds of things in terms of morality as well. You know, skirts were coming up, becoming shorter and so forth. So why was jazz innovative? Moving from classical music to jazz. And what are the differences? So the first thing is that in classical music, everything is pre-planned, right? You read from a sheet of music, everything is pre-composed. But in jazz, almost everything is improvised. Typically, anywhere from perhaps, you know, 75 to 100% of what jazz musicians play is improvised. You may hear them play some melody that you know, but really a lot of it is improvised. Even when someone is playing a melody that everyone may know, underneath that, the rhythm section, the bass player, for example, the guy that's playing on the piano, they're all improvising what they're doing. The content moves from a very strict form of content where you have to follow a lot of rules to a much freer form where there are much less rules. So this is great because it means that there is the possibility to do great things. Also the possibility to crash and burn as well. Diversity is a very important element in jazz. So if you think about, for example, a symphony orchestra, you think about, say, the violin section. You have first violins and second violins, and you'll have a number of those. So you might have 10, 15 people all playing the same first violin part. The equivalent of a symphony orchestra in jazz is a big band. And in a big band, every single person is playing an individual part. There's no backup, no redundancy at all. So there's a much greater degree of diversity in jazz. And if you look at even small group jazz, typically those players are all playing very differently. They have very different, you look at the groups of, say, Miles Davis, for example, and if you know about the way Miles Davis played. He played very sparsely, not many notes, but he would often choose saxophone players, for example, Coltrane, for example, to play with, who played a lot of notes. So there was great variation in musical styles. Leadership is one of the really key differences. So you think about, again, about a symphony orchestra, it's very hierarchical, right? You have a conductor, it's very command and control. In a jazz group, especially a small jazz group, there, at many points, it's not that there is no leader, but the leadership or the role of leading is changing all the time. And in terms of production, the way in which the music is actually made and the way that the musicians interact with each other and the way they interact with audiences, there's a big difference there. So in classical music, there's less interaction between the musicians. There doesn't have to be as much because there's not as much change that's going on that they have to deal with. But also if you go to a classical music concert and you look around, you'll typically see the audiences are, you know, quite composed. It's all very polite. And there are all kinds of silly rules even about when you can applaud. Right? You can't applaud until the end of a piece, you can't applaud after movements, and you certainly can't applaud while the music is being played. And that's sort of funny because back in Mozart's time, it wasn't that way at all. It was actually more like the way jazz is today, in which audiences can applaud basically whenever they want. They applaud in the middle of the music after someone has done something that they appreciate, and they applaud after a piece. And sometimes they even shout out, and sometimes the musicians shout out. Right, and that's really what it used to be like. And so we've now evolved to something where the production is a lot more closed. So my contention now is that we're in a second jazz age. So if you have a look at what's happening today, of course, change is the ever-present element. Right, and that's really what Agile is about. Right, it's about dealing with change. And we have change all over the world. We have a financial crisis that's not unlike the Depression. And things are moving so quickly. And there are many examples of companies, for example, that were at the top and now they're gone, right, or they're at the bottom. And in terms of innovation, we have sort of similar innovations. It's really all about the internet now. The internet is bringing people together. So it's sort of playing a similar role to what the automobile and the aeroplane did, but it's all happening virtually now. And in terms of media, of course, the media also, in the same way that radio and movies with sound played a role back in the 20th century, we have much richer forms of media, of content, that we can deliver across the internet. So what I think is interesting then is to think about how you can apply jazz in today's context in software development or in business or in any other field. So you may ask, is this a really valid parallel or analogy to make? It may be cool, but how relevant is it really? So the thing is, when you think about the way jazz musicians are playing, we have people who are individuals who are each playing their own part, and they have to constantly integrate what they're doing into a combined sound. So that's very similar to what happens in software development. They have to be very passionate and committed about what they do, and this is true for everything. But it's very obvious in jazz, right? You can see when the musicians are really into it, that spurs the other musicians on, the audience gets into it as well. And there's a very obvious synergy, because if you were to take, for example, and this is true in any form of music, if you have a band and you ask each of those musicians to play their parts individually, it's not that interesting. But if they play them all together, right, then you've really got something, and that's the synergy. Now, they have to deliver. Any artistic performance has to deliver on time. So what I mean by that is, if we've got a gig or a concert scheduled, we can't just decide, you know, the day before that we're not going to do the concert because, for whatever reason, right? If something happens, someone loses their instrument, or goes missing, or whatever the case may be, the performance has to continue, has to go on as scheduled. So you have to find a way to deliver on time. And quality is very important. So you think about any musical performance, even if there are, you know, if you say, let's just say you have 100 musicians in a symphony orchestra and they're each playing 1,000 notes in a concert, that's 100,000 notes. So even if you have a very small tolerance for defects, for bugs, wrong notes, it only takes a small number of those, or maybe even just one, to mar the performance. So quality is really important. And when musicians or any artists are performing, they're doing it live, it's real time. And so if it's live, it's being scrutinized constantly. And of course, they're doing what everyone has to do when they deliver a product or a service, right? They have to get customers somehow. They have to make it interesting and compelling enough that they can get customers and retain them, right? That's the audience. So the problem, as I see it, is that we have a lot of teams and organizations that are really playing classical music, and they really ought to be playing jazz. So how do you do this? And it's really all about principles. So we're going to talk about this in two forms. One is the structure of an organizational team. How do you put together a team that can be really effective? And then how do you actually make music? How do you make it happen? What are the elements that are important in the execution? So the first thing is that people are the most important thing. It may seem obvious, but for some reason, we get caught up in all of this tools and technology and processes, and we think that we can have all of that stuff and it will assure success, even if we have people who really don't have a clue. And it just doesn't work that way. And it's very interesting, if you look at the military, especially the special forces, they really understand the importance of people. Think about the US Special Forces, for example. They have access to amazing military hardware, right? But they understand that without having that hardware in the hands of really competent people, it's really meaningless. John Boyd is a very interesting person. If you don't know about him, you should read up on him. He was a fighter pilot, then became an instructor, and was also an aircraft designer, and was known as the father of the F-16 and the F-18. He really understood agility. His thing was about agility in the skies, right? It was in, you know, dogfighting, aerial combat. And he was known, his nickname was 40 Second Boyd, so 40 seconds. So he had this standing bet at the fighter school where he taught. And he had this bet that where basically if he started in a dogfight in front, that he could maneuver in some way so that he would end up at the back and be able to deliver the kill shot. And he thought that regardless of any hardware that anyone might have, the way that in which the pilots operate, right, that's really the key element in order to win in an aerial fight. And if you look at those special operations forces truths, the first one is obviously the one that we're focusing on here, but the other ones are also very interesting as well. Right, it's really, quality is more important than quantity, and mass production really doesn't get you there. And of course, you can't do it after the fact, right? You've really got to get good people from the very beginning. The thing is, if you've got really good people, if you've got a great team of people, you can accomplish virtually anything. You should certainly have a great head start, right? Regardless of what other stuff that you may have. But in this industry especially, we really get caught up in this tools and technology, of course, especially for the people that are selling those tools and technology. But it's very easy as consumers, as users, as customers to get caught up in all of that and forget about people. So of course this may seem like a really obvious thing, right? Get good people. But where it gets interesting is not just about getting good people, but also in terms of building diverse teams. And so I talked before about diversity. The idea here is that you really value individuality. And it's a natural thing when you're building a team, you go out and you hire people who think and act like yourself. a very obvious thing to do. And in fact, that's really not a good idea, right? What you really want to do is to build a team that is diverse, right? If you have diversity, you have, as I said before, the possibility of creating greater things, also the possibility of failing as well, a greater possibility. You're much more likely to have synergy when you have complementary skills. So you think about a jazz band, for example. If everybody was playing saxophone in a jazz band, it wouldn't be as good as if they were each playing different instruments, right? If you had a software development team and everyone was just writing code and no one was doing anything else, testing or writing documentation, right, you wouldn't get very far. So when we say, you know, you hear people sometimes say one person can make a difference, and you sort of, you know, often people say, okay, yeah, sure. But that really is true, right? You can have 1,000 people, and if they all think the same way, they still may never be able to achieve what one person may be able to achieve, because that person may just think differently. So, of course, in the software development context, that's what we're really talking about. We're talking about a diversity of thinking and a diversity of skills and experience. So the thing is, think about these things when you're building teams. And you can think about these in a jazz context too. So for example, if you have a lot of people in a jazz band who tend to play at the front of the beat, they tend to rush a bit, and everybody in the band is like that, well, guess what happens? The band is going to rush, right? If everybody plays at the back of the beat, the band will drag. So you want to have some variation in there to even things out. You want to have people who are hungry for taking risk, they have an appetite for risk, and you want others who are conservative. So in a jazz band, there are a lot of risks that are being taken all of the time. People are going out there and playing things, trying things that they've never tried before, and you have to be very careful that you keep things stable and it doesn't crash and burn. So if you've got a lot of people who really tend to take a lot of risks, you know, there's always that possibility. So you want to have someone, often, at, you know, for example, the bass player or the drummer, they have to really lock it down and they have to keep things very stable. So same in a software development team. If you've got lots of people who are always trying to do crazy stuff, squeeze things in at the very end, then, you know, what may happen, right? You may end up with a broken build right on the day that you're supposed to make something available. So there's an interesting study that looked at how diversity plays a role in innovation. And if you think about innovation, it's a two-step process. You're trying to generate many solutions to a problem, and then you're trying to select the best one. And this is two different forms of thinking. One is divergent thinking, generating the solutions, and the other one is convergent thinking, where you're trying to select the best solution. And you can think of this somewhat simplistically as left brain and right brain thinking. So in theory, people who are very good at logical things, mathematics, science, are very good at convergent thinking, right? They can say, what is the best solution? They can answer the question to what is the best solution for this. People who are more creative thinkers are more likely to be able to generate solutions. Right, so you give them something and say, how many different uses can you find for this thing? But you really need a combination of those things in order to innovate. So the claim here is that when you have more diversity in a team, you have a greater possibility of generating interesting solutions, and you have a greater possibility of selecting the right solutions. So the end result is that you end up with that the single solution that you select will be a better solution. So this is a very interesting study, and I've quoted it down there at the bottom. You can check it out. It's they actually analyzed 500,000 patent inventions and looked at the way people network with one another, the kinds of interactions that went on between the inventors. So the thing about diversity, as I said, is that you have this greater possibility for doing interesting things, for delivering things that are compelling, but there's also the possibility of crashing and burning. So how do you mitigate that risk? And the bottom line is that you really have to have people who are willing to put the team and the deliverables of the team before anything else that they're doing. So, you know, when I put together a jazz band, for example, I'm really looking for people who are really individuals that can stand out and they can do their own thing and bring something that's unique to the performance. But at the same time, I don't want them going way off to the point where the thing crashes. So there are many examples of this from different domains, and I have some interesting quotes there. Right, it's really all about, in jazz, it's all about, as Oscar Peterson says, the group sound. So it's really all about getting people who are really great virtuosos, but trying to balance that in some way with the team stability. So you've got a team of people together, team of really great people. It's a diverse team. How do you go about leading that team? So let me ask this. How many of you are in your work, in your organizations, how many of you are leaders in software development? Okay, how many of you are not leaders? Okay. So the thing is that everybody, when asked the question, are you leaders, should be able to put up their hand, right? And this is, if you want to build an agile organization, you have to have an organization in which everybody can take initiative. That's really what leadership is, right? It's taking initiative. So that means that, for example, if you see that things are wrong or you see that things could be done better, you can say, you can call that out. That's what leadership is all about. So in order to have an organization, to have a team like this, you have to have autonomy for people to allow them to lead. If you straitjacket them and constrain them, they won't be able to do that. And there's no way you can get agility like that. So if you want to build an agile organization, you have to have people who are agile. And leadership is, the decentralization of leadership is very important also because it builds robustness, because you've always got this possibility that people can speak out and identify problems. Now, in order to do this, people have to be good at both leading and following. That's really important. Because again, going back to the team stability, right? You want people that can say things and do great things, but they also have to be willing to sacrifice their ego for the good of the team. So here's an interesting jazz example. Miles Davis, one of the key figures in jazz, led a number of bands. One of the most notable bands was this first quintet. And this is a period that we're looking at from 1955 to 1964, where he led that group, and then over time, he added musicians, or musicians left the group. And I've just put underneath there the names of the albums, if you're interested in checking these out. This is really what's happening over this period of time, right? You'll see there's a real change in the personnel in the lineup, to the point where he gets to 1964, which is the formation of his second great group, the second quintet. But what's interesting about this is that during this time, those guys who we call the sidemen, it's not a politically correct term today, but it's a jazz term, the sidemen were also going off and doing their own things, right, leading their own groups. So this is what happens in jazz. Musicians are constantly leading groups, and they're playing as sidemen following in other groups. So think about what that might mean in an organizational context, right? If people are not always in very strict roles of leadership and following, right, where that can be dynamic. Now, the other thing that happens is that reallocation of leadership happens during jazz performances. So here I've illustrated it at a macro level, right? If you think about a jazz performance that might take anywhere from 3 to 10 minutes, during that performance, the musicians will play the melody at the beginning, perhaps, and then they'll each take turns improvising and soloing. And during that time, whoever is soloing or improvising is really sort of taking the lead. But In fact, that change of leadership happens all the time. It's actually constant. When someone is improvising, for example, and the rhythm section is playing underneath them, there are things that may happen that the bass player or the drummer or the pianist may do to take the music somewhere else. And anybody can do that at any time. So, of course, the obvious question when you think about that is, okay, that's pretty scary, right? How are you going to stop that from crashing and burning? And again, it's really because the musicians always have in mind the health of the performance, right? They always want to make sure that it does not destabilize. So in terms of production, in terms of execution, I talked about John Boyd before, and he came up with this very interesting model for execution called the OODA loop. So he divided up execution into four phases, in which you first observe and take stock of what is happening in your environment. You then orient to that. You figure out, so you take that data, you process it, you analyze it, and you figure out what is going on. You make sense of that data. That's essentially turning it into information that is useful. You then make a decision, and then you act on that decision. And then you use the feedback from that decision to then go into the next round of execution. So if you think about it, this happens all the time, right? It happens for us as individuals, no matter what we're doing. When we're just sitting somewhere, when we're standing somewhere, when we're talking to someone, when we're doing anything, we're constantly in this loop of execution, observing, orienting, deciding, and acting. And teams do this, organizations do this too, right? So organizations have their feelers out there, they're looking at what's happening in the market. They orient to that, they make sense of that, they process all of that that data, they produce useful information that allows people to make decisions, and then they act on those decisions. So John Boyd came up with this model for execution, and his context was, again, aerial combat, right? So it's all about two pilots facing off one another. How do you come out as the survivor in that? And his belief was that you have to execute faster than the other guy, right? You have to get inside the other guy's loop in order to beat them. And his strategies or his ideas have really been applied in many contexts. From a military point of view, his ideas were used in some of the major wars in the last 20, 30 years. He was active around the time of the Korean War. That's when he started to form these ideas. And as I said, he was also an aircraft designer, so he had these ideas about aerial agility and the way that aircraft performed. So he understood agility in terms of the way people think, as well as agility in terms of machinery and systems. So in this context of execution, if we begin with the first thing, it's all about observing. Now, of course, for Boyd, he was talking about aerial combat, so you're in the plane, and really what you have is your observation, right? You have your visual observation through the cockpit windows, as well as you have perhaps instruments as well. But, and for jazz musicians, for example, it's about listening. That's their form of observation, right? In a software development context, you have other ways in which you find out what is happening around you, what's happening in the build, what's happening with customers, requirements, and so forth. So that you're collecting that data. So if you think about this, for each one of us, in terms of our execution, when we're doing things ourselves, when we're writing code, whatever it may be, we're constantly aware of what we are doing. You think about a musician, for example, when they're playing their instrument, they're constantly aware of the sound that they're producing, whether they're playing in tune, and so forth. And then if you then go outwards to a greater context, the next level is the team, right? So for a musician, it's, okay, what's happening in the band around me? In a software development team, it's what's happening within my team. And then outside of that, you have this contextual or situational awareness that's needed in order to know what is happening. For example, for musicians, it's what's happening in the audience, in the room that they're playing in. If you're a software development team, it's what's happening with the people that we're delivering to, our customers, or perhaps also competitors as well, if you're in that kind of business. So it's personal awareness, team awareness, situational awareness. And we're constantly observing what's going on and then eventually acting on that. And of course, one thing that's hard, right, is it's very easy to get information overload nowadays. You have to find some way of knowing what's going on, keeping track of what's going on, but also rejecting the things that are not interesting, right? So you know this well from your email inbox, for example. So awareness is a really important thing. It's more important probably than anything else. And you think about people, for example, who are not very aware, are not very aware of their own individual actions. And you see sometimes some guy's in a job interview and he's got his sweater on inside out or back to front. Or you're driving down the road and some guy's got his indicator or blinkers on, but he's not actually turning, he's just going, keeps going straight, right? So these people they're lacking individual awareness, right? Or again, if, you know, in a driving context, you're in a situation where you're on the road and someone does something, they have no clue that someone else is there and they do something and, you know, cause an accident, right? Because they don't have awareness of what is happening around them. In jazz, we have this term, big ears, right? If someone has big ears, it means that they're a really good listener. It doesn't mean that they're Mickey Mouse. Mickey Mouse is probably a good jazz musician, but it means that they're very aware of what is going on around them, and that's a really, really important thing. And interestingly, if you look at people who are really strong practitioners in any domain, the thing is, not only can they do whatever it is that they do well, but it allows them to have more CPU cycles, more brain power left to think about what is happening around them. Right, so if I'm a jazz musician and I have to spend all my time thinking about where I'm going to put my hands on the instrument and how I'm going to produce this sound and so forth, I have nothing left in order to determine what is happening around me within the band and what's happening in the room. So I want to be good enough, I want to practice enough so that all of those things happen on autopilot, the basic fundamental things, so I can just do my stuff just like all of you do your things every day. A lot of those things you can do very easily because you're very good at them. And it allows you to then spend the rest of your time, the rest of your cycles, figuring out what's happening around you. So I like driving, so I use a lot of driving examples. So if you're going around a bend, where do you look? Right, so you're sitting in your car, and you've got the windscreen there, so you're looking out through the windscreen. Now, if you're going to turn left, what window are you looking out? So it's left side, right? You look to where you want to go, right? Can you imagine if you were driving around, turning corners, turning bends, and all you ever did was look out through the front window? That wouldn't be very good, right? You want to see where you're going. And especially if there's something that presents a problem, you don't want to be looking there. You want to be looking there. And furthermore, you don't just want to be looking there at the problem, constantly looking at the problem. It's like when you're driving and you see that pothole in the road and you say, there's a pothole, don't hit the pothole, don't hit the pothole, don't hit the pothole, and you hit the pothole. Because you keep looking at the pothole instead of where you should be going to get around the pothole. This is an actual example of a route that I take when I go to work every day. So I'm at point A there, and I want to get to B onto the highway there. And there's an on-ramp where I have to sort of go around. And what happens is that often there's a lot of traffic. And I'm trying to get to work on time, and I have to figure out what is the best route. Now, I can either get onto the highway, or I can go straight up. I actually have two further options. Sometimes I go up, and then I turn around, and I come back on the other side, so I sort of cheat a bit. Or sometimes I have to take a completely different route. But in order to determine how bad the problem is, when I look at the traffic, I need to not just look at what's happening directly in front of me, number one there, but I need to look outwards, right? This is peripheral vision, and trying to take in what's happening So this is really upstream and downstream, if you think about it, right? Which is exactly what we have in software development, right? We have this stream of things that happen. And so this is really about being aware of what is happening upstream and downstream and how changes have an effect on other people within the team. So when you break something, for example, what's the effect of that, right? Often that can cause a lot of churn for other people. And that's really, when we talk about team awareness, right, it really is talking about respect, having respect for what everyone else is doing in the team and not breaking them. So of course, in terms of execution, the thing is that you can listen and intently and listen as much as you want or observe as much as you want, but there's really two sides to it. So someone can listen intently, but if the person who is doing something that the other person is listening to or watching for is not doing it in a way that is easily readable, it will be very hard for them to figure out what's going on. So if I was speaking very softly, you wouldn't be able to understand what I was saying, right? Or if I was speaking in a language that you didn't understand, Australian accents don't count, it would be hard for you to figure out what's going on, what I'm saying. So the way that you act is very important. In a jazz band, we're doing things, we're improvising, and there are things that are happening that we've maybe never done before. So I play a lot of gigs, for example, where I play with people that I've never played with before, we play music that we've never played before, and we get together and immediately we're performing in front of an audience and we have to figure out how to play right there on the spot. And one of the really important things, apart from listening to what's going on, is making sure that you give very clear signals as to what you're doing. And often for us, those signals are musical signals. We can't transmit them any other way. Sometimes we can give a bit of a nod of the head or something, or a little hand signal, right? But most of the time it has to be done through the music. And it has to happen split second. There's no, you know, you can't stop and say, hold on, what did you mean? So transparency is very important. And it's a very alluring thing, too. People like transparency. They're curious to know what goes on, the way things work. So things can't always just be a black box. And you think about, for example, companies that sell products or services, is it really enough that they can just produce something good without anybody knowing about how that is produced? In some cases, yes, but often that's not the case. People want to know. They want to know, for example, that company is producing things in an environmentally friendly manner. They want to know that they're not performing illegal acts and lots of other things, right? So transparency is about acting in a way that's authentic, that's genuine, right? Genuine basically means that when I tell you something, when I communicate something to you, it's the truth, right? I'm not faking it or making something up. That's really what's going to happen. So if I say, for example, that my intent is to deliver this by the end of this iteration, that's what I'm going to try and do and not anything else. And of course, I'm being very open about it. I'm not requiring you to come and inquire and dig through lots of stuff to try and figure out what's going on. I'm being very upfront about my intentions and what I'm doing. And of course, I have to do it very clearly. And timeliness is very important as well. Because if I say to you, for example, listen to the next thing I say, but then I don't say anything for 10 minutes, and then I say something, you're probably going to miss it. So it's very important to do things in a timely manner. So two sides of it there, right? That's really the observing and the transparency, right? This is really about speeding up execution. Being very aware of what is going on and acting in a way that allows people to be aware of what is going on. And this is really a problem in a lot of teams, right? Again, you can have great tools and technology. Now, you know, you can have tools, for example, that help you do these things, but you really have to have the mindset to want to act openly and transparently and to want to know what's going on around you. But there are tools, for example, that can help you be more aware of what's happening with your team. And this is especially important if you're running teams that are distributed geographically, physically, right? Because obviously it's a lot harder to know what's going on when someone is halfway across the world. So that concept of team awareness is very important, right? You want to know what people are doing. You want to know the results of what they're doing, what's happening in the build, what changes are people delivering, what are the results of testing, and so forth. And all the time when we're executing, it's highly important that we're always being aware of the feedback that we're receiving, what we're taking in, and processing that in such a way that we can constantly improve. So when I'm playing my instrument, for example, I play the bass and there are no frets on the bass. So it's very easy to play out of tune. So I'm constantly, when I play a note, I sometimes have to make these little micro shifts with my finger to try and play in tune, right? So I'm listening to myself and then I make a very quick change. And when I get together with a bunch of musicians and we're playing, I'm listening to how we're locking in together. And if we're not locking in together, I'm always trying to find some way to improve that, as I expect the other musicians are as well. And if we hear, for example, or we can determine that we're playing too loudly or we're not playing music that's exciting enough, or maybe it's too exciting for the audience, right, then we try to do things to improve that. So the problem is that in a lot of cases, people do things and they figure out something that works, so they say, okay, that works, we're going to establish that as our best practice. So there's two problems with that. The first is that the best practice is great, it works great until something changes. Right? And we say the change is an ever-present element. The second thing is that if you're saying that it's a best practice, you're implying somewhat that that's the best that you can do, that you can't do any better than that. So the thing is that if you are not performing retrospectives, when you get to the end of an iteration, or when you get to the end of a project, or at some point, if you're not looking at what you did, what went well, what didn't go so well, and trying to figure out a list of actionable steps that you can take to improve that and make things better, then you're basically saying we're perfect. So if you're not doing retrospectives, you really should think about doing them, because otherwise you're not getting any better. So agility is really about responding to change. That's why we have all the things that we're talking about at this conference, the tools, the technology, these processes. It's all about how can we respond to change. And the thing is that there's change, micro changes, small changes, but there are also aberrational events, things that are just come way out of left field that no one could possibly expect. And if you look around what's happening in the world today, that is often the case. There are natural disasters and things that happen that no one could have possibly expected. Look at the last 10 years. And this happens too, right, in business. There are organizations that were at the top, as I said, fell way to the bottom. They just really didn't have a clue that someone was going to come out of left field. Some little company, which is all of a sudden now a major threat. And often in business too, delivering first is often the most important thing, right? Even if it's not so great. Sometimes you've just got to get something out there. Again, it's not just for delivering into the market, but also for internal delivery as well. Sometimes people just need something, even if it doesn't do everything and it's not perfect. And the thing is that if you don't have an organization, you don't have people who are really agile, it can be really painful to try and do this, right? It can be very, very difficult. So how do you enable agile organizations and agile teams? Well, one of the elements is friction. Friction is all the little things that make it hard for you to do whatever it is that you're doing. So the term friction, at least in the business sense, comes from, some of you may know of von Clausewitz, who was a German military strategist, and he had this idea of friction in war. And he said that friction is it doesn't really matter until you have to do something repetitively, and all of a sudden it becomes a big deal. So if, for example, in order to run the build, because the build infrastructure is broken and there's not enough automation, you have to go and do a whole bunch of things, tasks, in order to run the build, that may not be such a big deal. But if you've got to do it 10 times a day, that becomes a real pain. And we all have these things that we have to do as software development professionals, whether we're writing code or developing test cases, testing, whatever it may be. So we have to find ways in order to reduce that friction to make each of those things go more smoothly. So for example, if you have a whole mishmash of tools and you're trying to figure out how to do something, and in order to do that, you have to context switch constantly and move between a whole bunch of different tools, that's friction. So if you can integrate those things better with less context switching, right, then you're reducing the friction. And rules also cause friction. So if you have too many rules, it makes it very hard for people to do things. Now, of course, you've got to have enough rules. That's the thing, right? You can't have no rules. Imagine what would happen if you were driving on the road and there were no rules at all, right? It'd be total chaos. But in jazz, there are very few rules. There are fundamental rules that are important, but we're trying to reduce the number of rules in order to free up people so that they can do interesting things. Trust is something that is very important. When I'm in a context and I'm playing jazz, I really have to trust the other musicians. And the most interesting stuff happens for me when I'm playing jazz, and if I'm, say, playing a trio, all three musicians are all going off in their own directions, doing things that are really interesting and compelling, but I can trust that the other musicians will always know where they are, and they will always bring it back to a place that is stable. Right? And I'm always trying to do the same too, and that way I know that things will not crash and burn, and that we'll maintain something that's cohesive. Doing less with more is really important. For those of you that have heard Miles Davis play, he had a style in which he played very sparsely, didn't play many notes. But he was able to still come up with something that was really meaningful and compelling. And you think about writing code, for example, writing more code is not better than writing less code, right? Writing more code consumes more space, it's usually slower to execute, more stuff to debug, more stuff to go wrong. So you've got to figure out ways to do more with less. And of course, you have to take risks, right? If you want to get ahead, if you want to do interesting things, if you want to be better than the next company, you've got to find ways to take risks, calculated or measured risks. So in terms of making contributions count, here's an example of, say, four people who are involved in a team activity. And this could be anything. They could be developing software, they could be playing jazz. And every one of them is going through this little loop that I talked about before, this OODA loop, where they're observing and then orienting and deciding and then they're acting. So each one of those four people has in their mind what they're doing. So let's just say they're delivering code. So they're thinking about what they're going to do and they're estimating how much effort it will take them to do something and how much value it will add to the project and the impact that it will have on the rest of the team. But of course, what happens is things don't always turn out as we expect them to. Sometimes you do something and it takes way more time and effort than you expected, and the amount of value that you expect it to add may not be, right? The customers may come back and say, you know what, that's really not that interesting. It's not as cool as you think it may have been. And sometimes the impact of making a change generates a lot of work for other people, and they may have to go and do something in order to fix things up. Sometimes we know about that change, we know that there will be a change and it will propagate downstream and will require people to respond, but it's a lot better, for example, if we can give people notification of that. So we can say, we're going to make a change, and in order for this change to ensure to be adopted so that things don't fall apart, right, here are all the teams that will be affected, and here's what you'll have to do. or at the very least, here are all the teams that will be affected and you need to figure out what you're going to do, right? And let's track what you have to do in order to adopt that change. So it's really important when you are playing music or doing software development to be really aware of what you're doing and the impact that it has on the rest of the team. Okay, let's do a little bit of a exercise. So I'm going to ask you to do something for me. I'm going to ask you to read something together as a group. So you're going to perform as a group. And I know you've never done this all together before, but you're going to improvise. So, okay, so this next point that I just put down there, the top point is manage, and underneath that there are a number of points. So I'm going to ask you, I'll say 1, 2, 3, go, and ask you to then read the 4 points that are underneath manage. Okay, you ready? 1, 2, 3, go. So that was somewhat in sync. It would have been more in sync if we could have heard each other more clearly. But what you'll find, right, is that when people do an exercise like that, and think about, for example, reading something in a setting like church, for example, the congregation reads something, and they've never practiced reading whatever it is that they read, in some cases, right, but somehow it all falls into rhythm, and they fall into the same cadence of reading together, right? And that's a concept known as entrainment, right? It means that when you have two systems that are oscillating differently, somehow they come together in the same rhythm, right? People are attracted to rhythm. So what does this mean? In a jazz example, there are a lot of things that are going on that leverage this idea of entrainment. So for example, we have a structure or a form for a song. So, for example, the Flintstones, you probably know that tune. The Flintstones has a structure, beep-bop, 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 which is the first section there, A, and then comes back around to the second line where you repeat that again. And then you go to the bridge, this middle section, beep-bop, beep-bop-bop-bop-bop-da, bop-bop, and then you go back to the A section. Ba, 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 ba. So there's a structure to that, right? And there's a tempo whenever you play some song. So you could play it really fast. 1, 2, 1, 2, 3. Da, ba, beep, ba, 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 ba. Or it could be really slow. 2, 3, 4. Dip, bop. Beep, ba, dip, bop. And there is a pulse. Even while that there's a tempo, there's always a pulse that is happening. So what do I mean by that? So without getting into the real musical elements here, every one of those boxes there is a bar of music, and every bar, every box has 4 beats. So it's 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 4. Ba, 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 7, 2, 3, 4, 8, 2, 3, 4, 1. And then on the second line there. So the pulse, if you listen to what, for example, the bass player does in a jazz band, they're playing the bass line, and you may hear them play some dum, 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 dum. So it's like this. If I sort of clap it out, it's like bop, 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 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1. So I'm clapping on 1, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1. But I could clap on 3, bop, 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 1, 3, 1, 3. Or bop, 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 bop. So that's the pulse, right? The pulse is a function of the tempo. It could be a pulse on every beat, or it could be a pulse on every second beat, it could be a pulse on every fourth beat. And then there's a groove, right? So the way I'm sort of singing the Flintstones there, it's a kind of a swing kind of a thing. Dip, bop, bip, a dip, bop, bip. But I could do it sort of, say, as a kind of a more straighter thing that might be a, like a Latin kind of thing. Bip, bop. Beep, bop, beep, beep, bop, 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 bop. Now, what do I mean by all this? Think about this in a software development context. You have a structure for your project, right? It has iterations. This structure is really important, right? Everything has a structure, whether it's a campaign, a marketing campaign, or business campaign, something that takes 3 years, whether it's something that takes 3 minutes, right? A short jazz performance may take 3 minutes, but it has a structure that you follow, and there are checkpoints, and it's important to have those checkpoints. If you have checkpoints that are too far apart, it'll be very hard for people to track what's going on. They need those signposts. If you have checkpoints that are too close together, then people spend a lot of time on those checkpoints and not enough time doing all the stuff that's interesting in between. So you have this project form, and it defines these milestones, and you use these for delivering features or stabilizing, fixing bugs and stabilizing the code. And there's a tempo. So if we think about the tempo as each day, right, each business day, that's like each beat of the music. And there's a pulse. We could say the pulse is a weekly pulse, right? So we're only sort of clapping effectively every 7 days, right? That's the pulse. And then there's a groove, right? The groove is this combination of all these little things that happen together. So the groove in jazz is, for example, the rhythm section, the drummer is playing all these different things on the cymbals and drums, and the bass player is playing, and all that interlock is the groove. And there's a similar kind of thing in any team. You have a whole bunch of things that happen, builds and test passes and meetings and so forth, that happen on a regular basis. So here's an example. This is actually from one of the projects I work on. We have these three-week iterations. And every day we know what our rhythm is, right? We do two builds a day, for example. We have a meeting of the project management committee at the beginning of the week. We have meetings of the team leaders twice a week. And at the end of every week, we try to produce something that's consumable, a build that people can take, that's stable. And in the third week, it's a special week, it's a milestone week, where we really focus on stabilization because we want to put something out there that people can get. So, the project that I work on, for example, is at this website, jazz.net. You can go out there and you can see that we put out stuff every 3 weeks. It varies depending on the project. But in that third week, we do special things. We quicken up the tempo, we quicken up the pulse there, and we have double the number of meetings, right? So instead of having two meetings, we have four meetings. So these are your scrum meetings, right? So that rhythm is really important. Everyone needs to know about that rhythm. Everyone needs to know about the groove of all those things that interlock together, right? That's what makes things move. And you really have to have a lot of respect for that. You can't, if you upset that, it throws everybody off. So the thing is, in jazz, you can do things that are delayed or anticipated that come before the beat or after the beat, right? You just still have to have respect for that beat and that pulse, and you don't want to upset that, otherwise it's going to throw off the music completely, and the music won't groove, it won't swing, right? It won't be very compelling at all. And this is looking at, in a software development context, it's looking at rhythm at a macro level, right? So again, this is on one of the projects I work on. We deliver a major release sort of around the middle of the year, and then we have these maintenance releases that we deliver. So we have four of them or three of them each year, right? So we're basically releasing every 3 months. And we have this rhythm. We know that we follow this rhythm all the time, right? And it makes it easy for everybody that's working on the project and people that are consuming the products to figure out what's going on. And the last thing I want to leave you with is this idea of health, right? This is a really important thing. We know about the health of builds, for example. Most of us are probably tracking what the health of the build is. We know how many defects are in the build. We know whether the build was broken, whether it was green or it was red, or whatever it is that's used to determine the health of the build. But the thing is that projects and teams, organizations, all have health as well. And it's really important to be always aware of that. Because the thing is that when you are constantly pushing things all the time and things are getting unhealthy or unstable, if it's a positive feedback loop, right? Like, I mean, it's when you get sick, if you don't stop and rest, if you keep pushing yourself all the time, you're just going to get sicker. And if you just really keep pushing it, right? I never understood when I was younger why, for example, you know, you'd hear about these athletes, really great athletes, and they would injure themselves so easily. They'd, you know, go off the starting block in a sprint and pull a muscle. And I said to myself, you know, that never happens to me, right? But of course, I wasn't performing at that level, right? When you're really performing at a very high level, it's easier to lose health, to get injured. And so you really always need to be aware of the health of the organization, of the project, and of the code, the software. Of course, prevention is better than cure. So anything that you can do, now, you know, we hear these discussions sometimes about debt, technical debt, organizational debt. That's really what that's all about, right? When you have a lot of debt, right, that's things that are unhealthy. And if you let that debt build up, it can be a really bad thing. And then, of course, you get into this situation where you have so much debt, then all you're doing is servicing the debt. And then things go really downhill very quickly. It spirals down very quickly. And the thing is, nobody wants to work on a project that's sick, right? It's not attractive. Just like when someone is sick, you don't want to go near them, right? You stay away. So we all want things that are really healthy. We want to work on healthy projects. So in summary, you want to build the right structure, right? Get good people. Introduce diversity into the teams. Leverage diversity. Don't build meritocracies. You may have seen that on one of the earlier slides, right? Don't just hire people who think and act like yourself. Think about getting someone who may be different, because that person may be able to introduce something to the team that is completely new and interesting. It all works the opposite way as well, of course. Decentralized leadership. Give people autonomy so that they can take initiative and lead, right? If you collect all of the, or constrain all of the leadership to a few people, things will move a lot more slowly. And be open about the way that you produce in terms of the way that you interact with one another in teams, as well as the way that you interact with your consumers, your customers. So the projects that I work on, we develop all this software at a website at jazz.net, and we put stuff out there, and you can go there and you can see what we're doing. You can see how many bugs we have. You can see how well we're doing. You can see our plans. You can see whether we're tracking well against our plans or we're not tracking well. You can provide feedback, submit bug reports. And all of that feedback is really useful for us. So the great thing about it is that when we're doing well, everyone can see that we're doing well. The bad thing is when we're not doing well, everyone can see that we're not doing well, right? But also that pain of not doing well and everybody seeing that is really helpful for us, right? Because it really motivates us to do better. Build agility, reduce friction, make contributions count, make sure you have trust, develop trust so that things move more quickly. Rhythm is probably one of the most important things here, really, right? If you think about what we do in agile software development, all of these iterations, all these things that happen on a regular basis, that's really the key to keeping things moving along smoothly. It's really important. And when people do things that upset that rhythm, when they break builds, right, on the last day, that causes problems, right? People have to have respect for these time boxes. Right, so you say, this is the fixed time that you're going to deliver stuff in, and you do that. You don't try and squeeze stuff in at the very end. Right, you just shift it to the next iteration. And of course, health, right? You want to try and keep things healthy, because those are the projects that everyone wants to work on. So if you'd like to know more about this stuff, as Lee mentioned, I have a book. I also blog when I get the time at this website, jazzprocess.com. And you'll see if you read any of that stuff, that a lot of things I've talked about are principles that are at work, not just in music, but in many other domains as well. Right? And I think these are fundamentally way more important than any of the tools and technology and processes that we may talk about. Right? Of course, having those things is great, and they will certainly help. But if you have those things and you don't have any of the things that I talked about today, things won't go well. So we have a bit of time left. I wanted to take any questions if there are any. At the back.
We have microphones and runners around. We have a question from our virtual audience.
There we go. Okay, this comes from our virtual audience. The toughest challenge in the Agile way of working is that individual teams go for their own synergy and patterns and often miss the organization's larger flow of ambitions. So do you have any suggestions to streamline this?
Well, I mean, I don't have any quick things to say about it other than, you know, again, it really comes down to having respect for these contexts, right? So I talked about within a team having respect for the team context and being willing to sacrifice egos for the good of the team, right? And the thing is, you see in organizations these turf wars between teams all the time, right? It happens sometimes between teams that are doing the same things, software development teams. It happens between disciplines, between, say, you know, a software development team and, you know, a marketing team, for example, right? And if you want to have an organization that works, that functions with agility, right, you really have to have respect. That's really what it's all about. I mean, I talked about building trust, but you may have noticed that you said trust and respect, right? And that's really what it's about. You have to have respect for what other people are doing. And you may notice when musicians play jazz, for example, they're always very respectful and encouraging of what other musicians are doing, even if sometimes they don't actually like it, right? It's always what you will see, right? Musicians will always be sort of cheering each other on, and someone will play a solo or doing something, and the other musicians will go, yeah, that's great, right? Because they always have respect. And the thing is that sometimes there are things that are black and white, and it's obvious when something is wrong. But that's not always the case, right? And so, for example, in jazz, when someone plays something, it may not be what you would have played, but it may still be really interesting and compelling, right? And we all have different tastes, so someone, you know, may not have liked it, but someone else may have, right? So it's really about having respect for what other people are doing.
Other questions?
Another one from the back.
You mind taking another one from our virtual audience?
Yes, I don't see any others here.
Unless anybody here? Okay. Okay, this gentleman asks, I've seen many teams discard input by sending the potential contributors off to read more before accepting their input at all. How can this behavior be improved?
Well, I think that going back to that model I had there with the picture of what people are actually doing in terms of their contributions, right? The thing is that everyone's contribution has to count for something. And the thing is that you can contribute a small amount or you can contribute a large amount. It really doesn't matter, right? Now, obviously, as I showed in that diagram, right, there's value that you add. That's really what it comes down to. It's not how much code that you write. It's what value does that add, right, in terms of the function or, you know, stabilizing if you're fixing bugs in the code base. So the thing is that everyone has to figure out some way and of making a contribution that adds that value and reduces the amount of churn. And people who are coaching those people or setting up the framework for them to make their contributions have to do that as well. So the bottom line is you have to help people be successful. Right? This is one of the important things about being a leader, right? Is you have to put people in places and set things up for them to be successful. It seems like an obvious thing, right? I mean, why would you set people up to fail? But unfortunately, it happens a lot of the time, right? And so if, for example, developers are asked to deliver something, but there are all these things, and I talked about friction, right? All these things that get in their way There may be organizational things, or there may be infrastructure issues because it's really hard to deliver code or run the build or whatever it may be, right? Then that makes it very hard for them to get their job done. So I think definitely going back to the point of friction is very important, making it possible for people to be successful.
Right, thank you very much.
Thank
Adrian?
You. Thanks, Ed.
Just a great message. Before I read his book, I just didn't understand this connection between jazz musicians and the kind of things that we do, and there is so much of a connection. And I just really appreciate this message. Plus, I didn't really know who Miles Davis was until I read his book, and then I spent a whole day just listening and enjoying that music. Again, it's break time now. We'll reconvene at 10:15. Remember the green sheets. This is
All right, thank you for watching Adrian Cho's presentation. In a few minutes, Bob Aiello will be interviewing Adrian in our lounge area here from the conference floor. So, if you're interested in watching that interview, which I hope you are, just visit us at the Lounge and Resource Center to watch this live interview again from the floor of the Better Software Conference and Agile Development Practices East Conference. Hope to see you there and at our next presentation. Thanks.